All right. What I would like to do is I'm going to begin by very briefly recapitulating some of the points that I made in my previous class. So recall that what we've been doing so far is we've been looking at the history of the East India Company, and we have approximately arrived at around 1700 in our narrative. We disrupted that political narrative, that political history, in order to be able to look at the kind of questions that are raised by William Dalrymple in his book, by a number of other scholars as well, but that's a book that's received quite a bit of attention. White Mughals, and you've just read, you know, about 80 pages from that book. I mean, for those of you, incidentally, I mean, this is a little tip about the reading that, you know, sometimes you might find that the Dalrymple, for example, if you read the first 50, 55 pages, you're pretty much covered the points that he's really interested in making. So, you know, you have to use your own discretion about how carefully you're going to read, obviously, every page. But this is just a hint about how you might approach some of the readings, that once the major argument has been established and you're quite clear about it, then you can obviously skim, you know, the rest of that particular reading. The book itself is, you know, 450-some pages. So you're just reading, as I said, excerpts from this work. So what I'm going to do is briefly recapitulate some of the points, go back to Dalrymple, and then continue with our political narrative. And certainly today we're going to come to 1757. I was hoping to do that in my last lecture, but then realized that there are several considerations that might be left out if we try to rush into it a little bit. So as far as the recapitulation is concerned, recall that the company is founded in 1600. It receives a charter. The voyages to India start almost immediately thereafter. What you're going to find, at least for the first several decades, is the question about what is it that England is actually sending across to India and getting in return. And as I pointed out to you, essentially what England is going to be sending is bullion, and that's mainly silver. There's some copper. Not very much. There's gold, but silver is really the main export that England has. I mean, there are times when it's only bullion, but there are some other objects. So those objects would include things like, or goods would include woolen cloth, which was really of not much use to Indians, because if you know the geography and the climate of India, you know that there would be very little use for woolen cloth. You know, clothing, except obviously in the northern part of the country, in the Himalayan region. But the bulk of the population of India lives in the plains and then in the Deccan, so there would have been very little use for that. Tin and lead, these are the things that were sent across to India as well. But there was a period of time, I pointed out to you, when only bullion is going to be sent. And certainly going into the 1750s, you know, leading to the Battle of Plassey, that's going to be an important consideration, because one of the things we're going to find is that Indian bankers, I'm going to talk about them when we get to 1757, they're called the Jagat Seths. The Indian bankers are actually concerned. You know, I'm anticipating the argument, but simply, you know, focusing on the question of bullion here, they are concerned that the new ruler of Bengal in 1756, that he's putting pressure on them, and this might disrupt the trade. And if it disrupts the trade, then the import of bullion, okay, into India will stop. So they are going to actually support the British, because one of the things that we have to constantly ask ourselves is, you know, what were the circumstances that led Indians to abandon other Indians and side with the British, right? Because obviously, and if you read the pages that have been assigned to you, you know that one of the things that's going to happen in the Battle of Plassey is that the British are going to be able to take advantage of the divisions in Indian society, right? So bullion figures in the story here even all the way until 1756, 1757, right? So this is a trade that's going on, and gradually, you know, from the 1630s onwards, you're going to find that the profits of the company are going to increase quite substantially. Just to give you some sense of that, because I didn't really give you any figures for that, in the 1640s, the company's profits amount to about 20%. So 20% over the investment that they've made. By 1665, the profits of the company have increased to 40%, and in the period between 1685 and 1688, this is before the company enters into a war, a short war with Aurangzeb, and they suffer the consequences of waging a war against the Mughal emperor at that point. But just before the commencement of that war, in the few years before the commencement of that war, the company's profits have gone up to 50%. And this is after the deduction that you have to allow for. So, for example, what is a deduction? That the company had paid £170,000. All right, so £170,000, you know, by at today's rate, if allowing for inflation, obviously 250 years and all of that, what we're talking about is that would be the equivalent of something like, let's say, 18 million pound sterling, okay, which in turn would be about something like $30 million, okay. So this is the amount they are paying to the English monarchy, to the Stuart. So England is under Stuart rule. It's the late Stuart period that we're talking about here. So once you, and this is essentially so that the Stuarts don't, in fact, actually interfere in the affairs of the company, right? I mean, it's a bribe, effectively, that the company is paying to the English monarchy. So even allowing for that, we're still saying that the profits of the company in the 1680s are now about 50% over their investments. So the profit margin has obviously grown quite dramatically, right? One small detail which I have not mentioned to you, I mean, I've mentioned, of course, the fact that this is where you go back to the early 1500s, that the Portuguese had established themselves. We did talk about that. I did talk about the fact that the Portuguese are slowly going to be eclipsed by the British. But what I did not mention is the development of London as a great financial center. Right? And this is going to play a role, obviously, in the fortunes of the company, because once London itself becomes a great banking and financial center, which it continued to be for several centuries thereafter, this obviously increases the prospects for the English. Right? So that's essentially the backdrop that you have to keep in mind. Now, we were roughly around 1700, and recall that what has happened just before that, what's happened before that is that the company has now acquired the right to mint money. Its jurisdiction is going to run in the presidency towns, which are Bombay, Madras, and Calcutta. All these are ports. Calcutta is a port which is under British jurisdiction, and in its close proximity is what is called Hooghly, which is under Mughal jurisdiction. Okay, but the Mughals were never really a sea power. They were never really, I mean, it was a land empire, you know. And what's going to happen as a company becomes more powerful is that gradually Calcutta is going to eclipse Hooghly, which is in the near proximity. I mean, talking about a few miles away, you know, because it's the same area. It's just that this is the Mughal port, and then Calcutta is this new port and the new port city, which is really established by the British. So what you are seeing here is an affirmation of the thesis that Panikkar had put forward, namely that when you begin to look at the British and the European presence, what you're talking about is the entrance into India of maritime powers now. Right, and this is one of the reasons, obviously, that led to the decline of the Mughals. That the Mughals really didn't have much of a navy to speak of, certainly not in comparison with what you find in Britain. And of course, technology is going to continue to develop. I mean, I know that there was a question which had been posed in, I think, one of the previous lectures, and somebody had, you know, we were looking at what might have been the reasons why the British were able to advance. And I was saying to you that, well, technology will not account for everything, might not account for very much at all. But certainly it's true that in the 1680s, when the company went to war with Aurangzeb, at that point they have met their match, more than their match. But in 1757, okay, when Clive is going to go to battle with the Nawabs of Bengal, at that point, the British have something of a military edge over the Indians as well. They also have a great many other things going for them, but we'll get to that in just a moment. Now, before we return to the political narrative, I want to introduce one new factor and then go back to the Dalrymple. And that one new factor I want to introduce is a group of people known as the Marathas, who are initially under the leadership of a man called Shivaji. Okay, I want to spend about 5-10 minutes on that because we're going to encounter the Marathas all the way until the early 1800s, when finally they are going to be defeated, okay, by the company. But they make their entrance into Indian history in the second half of the 1600s. So 1670s, 1680s, and thereafter. And the Marathas are a group of people. So this is a group of people from Western India, okay? And initially they are under the leadership. So this is Maratha territory, we might say. There's a city called Pune. The British name is Pune, okay? Same city. So if you look it up, you'll find it there. Inland, it's not on the coast, but not, it's part of the modern state of Maharashtra, which today includes the city of Bombay or Mumbai, right? So Western India. Now, I don't want to get into the entire history of who Shivaji is, although he's an enormously interesting character, and certainly in the history of British India is important only because his figure is going to be constantly revived by Indian nationalists, right? And sometimes Indian nationalist histories of the late 19th century very often depict Shivaji as the first great Indian nationalist, right? Now, was he the first great Indian nationalist or not? Let's leave that assessment aside for a second. Let's just consider who he is and why are we bringing him into the picture at this point in time, right? Because remember that what we are attempting to do now, we've reached about 1700, we're attempting to understand not only what transpires in the next 50 to 60 years, but what is it that facilitated the victory of the British, okay, over Indian forces, right? That's our other endeavor. Now, Shivaji emerges as a leader of this group of people known as the Marathas. The Marathas can be viewed as guerrilla fighters, okay? They can be viewed as a guerrilla force. So you could say that this is a new element in Indian history in the sense that, you know, I mean, I don't know that we would ever really use that word to describe other fighting forces in India before the advent of the Marathas. And who is he opposing? He's opposing the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb, okay? And recall that the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb, you know, has been able to extend his rule down into the Deccan, right? So the capital here is Agra. Agra and Delhi is the other great Mughal stronghold here. And he's been able to extend his rule all the way down into the interior, into deep down into South India, into the Deccan, right? However, this Deccan campaign lasts for well over a decade, this attempt to conquer the Deccan and bring it within the ambit of the Mughal Empire. Now, these Mughal armies were absolutely gigantic, okay? I mean, it's very difficult to comprehend today unless you're looking at something like, let's say, World War II, when again you're talking about war on a massive scale, okay? But when I say these armies are really gigantic, what I'm talking about is hundreds of thousands of foot soldiers. Then you've got cavalry. Then you've got elephants. So the use of the elephant as within the army, okay, you have to think of the game of chess, and there's a relationship. How did the game of chess develop? Why do you have an elephant or a rook? Okay, well, it goes back to the compositions of these armies, okay, in very early times. So you've got elephants, you've got foot soldiers, and these people might be on the road, so to speak, for years. Now, when you have armies of this size, you also need provisions. You need food, you need soap, clothes, right? You need cooks. If you've got food that you're going to serve to the soldiers, well, you need cooks as well. And what happens when you have armies of this size is there are always people. So when the army, okay, so you camp for the night, then the next morning you take off again, right? When you do that, there are always people who are going to be left behind. The ones who are, the soldiers who are getting tired, the non-combatants within the Mughal army, okay? And that's why I mentioned people like cooks and so forth and so on. There are a great many other people as well who are non-combatants. What the Marathas are going to do, okay, because certainly Shivaji is inspired by sentiments of what you might describe as nationalism. I don't know, I would want to call it Indian nationalism. What he's inspired by is the idea that, well, the Mughal, he views, you know, the Mughals as a foreign element, all right? But again, we would have to be very careful. So this is where we have to now bring in another element of the story, and that is this whole idea of communalism. Let me write it here. Communalism. And communalism is an idea that you have to get your ideas about this firmly in your head, because this is going to be a something that we're going to have to be thinking about all the way until the end of the course. So what is communalism? Very briefly, communalism is this view that Hindu-Muslim conflict has been the chief determinant of Indian history. Okay? That if you look at, I've spoken about this briefly before, you know, that if you look at India and you look at the nature of Indian identity, in India, religion is the core element of your identity according to the communalist view. According to the communalist view. Right? So that before a person thinks of himself or herself as, you know, as an intellectual or as a worker or as working class, right? So forth and so on. Or thinks of himself or herself according to their sexual orientation. Right? Before you think, because if somebody said, what is your identity, you could list 10 elements of your identity, you're male or female, you know, then you might have a sexual orientation, which may or may not correspond to your gender necessarily, right? Then, of course, your nationality, your linguistic affiliation, your political affiliation, so forth and so on. These are all elements of your identity. According to the communalist interpretation of Indian history, religion is the core element of Indian identity. Before anything else. It's the primordial element of your Indian identity. Now, you extrapolate from that to the next argument within communalism. So if you look at the nature of Indian history, the nature of Indian history is that Hindus have always gravitated towards other Hindus. Because people think, according to this point of view, largely, right, from the point of view of religion. So a Hindu will always gravitate towards other Hindus. A Muslim will always gravitate towards other Muslims. And some of you might say, well, isn't that always the case? Well, why should I be gravitating to another? And when I say gravitate, mean, for example, include them within my circle of friends, within my circle of acquaintances. Right? Now, I might say that the way I think about who my friends are going to be depends on their political orientation. You know, so let's say, I might say, if anybody is a member of a tea party, it's impossible that that person could be a member within my circle, let's say. Okay? That might be how you might think. Right? I'm not going to choose my friends according to their religious orientation. Now, the communalist view says that Hindus constitute a block of people, Muslims constitute a block of people. So if you have a Hindu working class person and a Muslim working class person, they're not going to bond with each other on the basis of class. Forget about Marx. That's great idealism according to this point of view, but it doesn't work that way because a Hindu will always gravitate towards other Hindus, a Muslim will always gravitate towards other Muslims. Okay? So now the communalist interpretation of Indian history, right, is essentially going to be what? For, as far as Shivaji is concerned, and then you'll understand why we're bringing Shivaji in here, right? So we're looking both at the political component of the argument and the ideological component of the argument. Essentially, what communalist history will do is it will read back this idea of communalism into the 17th century and say that Shivaji was a great Hindu nationalist who essentially fought Aurangzeb because he viewed Aurangzeb as a Muslim tyrant. Because of course the religion of the Mughals is Islam. That's who they are. They're Muslims. And Aurangzeb certainly views himself as a Muslim ruler. No question about that. Right? But the question is whether every action that he undertook politically was simply based on his understanding of himself as a Muslim. That would be an erroneous assumption. Okay? Just as it would be an erroneous assumption to assume that because Shivaji was fighting Aurangzeb, we should view this as a Hindu-Muslim conflict. No, that's the problem. And this is why we have to bring in this whole idea of communalism. So Shivaji, right? Now this is the ideological component of the argument. Is going to basically start waging war against Aurangzeb. Now, when you wage war against a great Mughal army, you have to use non-conventional tactics. That's where the idea of Shivaji as a guerrilla fighter comes in. And this is the relevance of talking about the size of the army, that what these Marathas are doing is, you know, they are at the heels of the Mughal army, right? And they're going to pick off people, okay? The stragglers, the people who are left behind, the people who are weak, the soldiers who are sick, they're essentially going to pick these people off and eliminate them. Because that's what you do. You're fighting a guerrilla war, and you have to use unconventional tactics against a armed force that is much greater than your armed force, right? That's the scenario that we're talking about. Now, the importance of this is the following. That so this is in the 1680s that we're talking about. Shivaji, of course, is going to eventually pass away. The Marathas, with the group of people that he leads, they will continue to be a great political force. And there's no question that one of the things that the Marathas were able to do was they were able to debilitate, weaken the Mughals. Now, the British are going to have to contend with them as well. But one of the reasons why the Marathas are interesting is that the Marathas are going to be associated with plunder and loot in the Indian imagination. So actually, Indian nationalist historiography, if it wants to push the Marathas into a position of eminence, has its work cut out for it. Because in India, even in India, the popular imagination viewed the Marathas as a kind of plundering force. Right? That these people are really, they're not going to establish a nation state or anything. That might well be the aspiration of the Marathas. Their reputation was that of people who were really a great plundering force. Okay? And they are basically a great irritant. Initially for the Marathas, debilitate them, they're going to be a great irritant and more for the English, until eventually the English are going to wipe out the Marathas, right, in the early 1800s. But it's going to take that long for it to happen. And when we think of what's happening in the 1750s and 1760s, one of the things that I'm trying to suggest to you now is that it did not help that the reputation of the Marathas was really bad. That is that if you're trying to imagine why is it that some people might have thought, hey, British rule is welcome, right? We don't have any problem with the British, right? But one of the reasons might have been is that certainly in places that had come under the Maratha sword, the memories of the Marathas were not exactly pleasant. And in fact, it used to be said very often that mothers would put their children to sleep by telling them that, well, if you don't go to sleep, the Marathas are going to come down and, you know, plunder this village that we're staying in, okay? There'll be consequences. Right, those are the folk tales that are very often told about the Marathas, but it gives you an idea of what kind of reputation they had developed. Now, Shivaji, of course, is also important for the reason that I mentioned, but we'll now take him up again, you know, much later towards the 8th or 9th week when we begin to see the development of a nationalist historiography where the image of Shivaji will now be revived as the person who was able to put forward the idea of Indian nationalism, so forth and so on. Okay? So much for the Marathas. The second element, before I get back to the political narrative, I want to go back to Dalrymple, because that's where I had stopped in my previous lecture, right? And I had suggested to you, we're going to just look very briefly at a couple of passages as well. So remember that, what is it that Dalrymple is trying to say? Dalrymple is trying to say, the book is called White Mughals, right? Love and Betrayal in 18th Century India, and the main narrative, right, to recapitulate, is this love story between an aristocratic Muslim woman, a young Muslim woman, a noble woman, and a colonial official, somebody who actually is in the employ of the East India Company, right? And Dalrymple is saying, well, how was this possible? How was this romance possible? What do we extrapolate from this romance? I mean, is this just, you know, an outlier, okay? Is this just an odd story? Or does this actually point to some significant patterns in Indian history, right? And what I want to do is I want to just quickly look at a couple of passages because recall that what he says that what is the evidence of the fact that Englishmen had embraced Indian culture? So they started smoking hookah, they started wearing Indian dress, they consorted with Indian women, right? So forth and so on. some of them, and he gives a few very extreme examples, a person called Hindoo Stuart. He also gives the example of a person, David Hare, who was believed by his countrymen to have abandoned his own religion, right? So that when he dies, he's not given a Christian burial because he's now viewed as a Hindu. This is the example of David Hare. Then he's got the example of Hindoo Stuart. There are a few such other examples as well in the book. And what we're asking is, so all right, so does this mean that India was extraordinarily multicultural in his sense? Because of course it was an immensely pluralistic society. I've already argued that, and I will insist on continuing to make that argument. Right? Because in fact, I've given you a much more radical argument in a way, and that argument was that, well, if we're trying to understand how the British were able to achieve the conquest of India, well, one of the many reasons why this conquest was possible is because I had argued that India was an extraordinarily cosmopolitan civilization. The element of diversity was huge here. And this also meant that India then becomes more vulnerable, especially to people who are coming from Britain, which is a largely homogenous society. Yes, I know there are differences between the Welsh and the Scots and the Irish, and I myself have pointed to these differences. And I know that there are differences between Protestants and Catholics and Quakers, and that there are numerous Christian sects, and there are groups known as the Diggers and the Luddites and so forth and so on. Yeah, I'm quite well aware of that. But that doesn't in any way point to the kind of diversity that we're speaking about in India, which includes immense religious, linguistic, cultural, culinary diversity, among many others. Right? That's the scenario that we're looking at. So the question is, what kind of multiculturalism is really William Dalrymple talking about? Now, let me begin with a quotation from him, bottom of page 6, if you want to look it up later on. Yet the more one probes in the records of the period, right? And the period he's talking about is roughly the early 1600s to about circa 1800. Right? Because he says very clearly in the pages that you have that by the 1780s, okay, the position had hardened, by which he means that certain kinds of racial and ethnic hierarchies start to become very clear. Right? So this is roughly 1600s to about 1800. Page 39, he says, ideas of racial and ethnic hierarchy were also beginning to be aired for the first time in the late 1780s. Right? And it was the burgeoning mixed-blood Anglo-Indian community which felt the brunt of the new intolerance. Right? And to put it in much more colloquial terms, for example, the word nigger is actually going to be used by Britishers when they are writing letters to people back home to describe Indians. Oh, I had an encounter with such and such nigger. You're not going to find that in the 1600s. You'll certainly find it in the 1700s, particularly the second half of the 1700s, going into the 1830s, 1840s. This word is going to be quite widely used, apropos the Indian community. Okay? Right? So far we are saying that, well, Dalrymple seems to be somewhat on the right track. So far it seems that way, because what he's suggesting is that, yeah, you know, racial intolerance grew 150 years after the British arrived in India, right? So forth and so on. And this argument is not new to him at all. This was well established 40, 50 years ago, if not much longer than that, right? But let's go back to what he is saying. Yet the more one probes, this is the bottom of page 6, yet the more one probes on the records of the period, the more one realizes that there were in fact a great many Europeans at this period who responded to India in a way that perhaps surprises and appeals to us today. He's assuming that everybody who's reading this is inclined towards pluralism and multiculturalism. Some people want to have nothing to do with it, actually. Okay. Surprising and appeals to us by crossing over. This is the crucial phrase. By crossing over from one culture to the other. And wholeheartedly embracing the great diversity of late Mughal India. Right? Now, the great diversity of late Mughal India, yes. But herein lies the problem. That what he's describing in this book are people who, in my view, are not actually bicultural anymore. These are people who have crossed over. They have, in fact, actually, in a way, renounced their own culture or civilization. Right? Now, I don't believe, by the way, that those can be the grounds for a true intercultural dialogue. Let me give you an analogy. Imperfect analogy, I grant you, but for the sake of argument, I think it will be sufficient and it will work. Right? If you look at the social, cultural, political history of any civilization, of any country, I think you would all agree, at least to this much, that relations between men and women are one of the key elements of that history. Okay, and these relations may be, described in numerous ways, they're different registers, right? But keep in mind relations between men and women. Now, if you look at contemporary societies, okay, now there's no question that some people, because what we're trying to understand is the idea of crossing over. Right? What does this really mean? How are we to understand this? You know? So for example, if a man embraces feminism to such a degree that he's viewed only as a feminist, is that an example of crossing over? Right? I don't think so. I don't think that that would be viewed as crossing over, really. If you had a sex change operation, then we could say you've crossed over. You've crossed over. Right? And there's some people who might say, well, yeah, the reason, I want a sex change operation is because, I've got the body of a man, but I've always had, felt like a woman or a girl, depending on what age you are, my sensibility is entirely feminine, so forth and so on. So my, I'm trapped in the wrong body, right? That would be one argument given for a sex change operation. Now, you could say, but that's a kind of a, what I would call a non-political argument. The political argument would be that if men, and incidentally there are more men who attempt to change to women, okay, lot more. Eventually the number of attempts that succeed is about the same, but if you look at the statistics, and historically speaking, by the way, most of the examples that we have looked at in scholarship across the world, the vast bulk of the cases that have come to light are those of men who cross over to become women. All right, so now what am I saying here? What I'm saying here is the following, that if you look at the political end of the political argument here would be that a man might say, I want to cross over because I don't want to belong to the oppressor class. Okay, that largely in most societies, men in fact have actually oppressed women. No question about it. And this doesn't, by the way, we don't have to then slip into that the other side of the view and say, well, women are always among the oppressed. I don't even want to go down that road, but I think that what is very clear is that in most societies that we know of, there has been a deeply hierarchical relationship between men and women. And power has largely resided on the side of men. And yes, I know that there are modes of resistance to that, so forth and so on. All right, those are different histories. So let's supposing that the reason you really wanted to do your sex change operation is that you felt that, hey, I don't want to belong to the class of people who are oppressors. I'd rather belong to those who are on the other side. That would be a political argument for why you might want to get a sex change operation. Okay? So I'm saying that's a form of crossing over, but that's obviously going to be extremely unrealistic as a model for developing intercultural and intersexual and harmonious relationships between men and women. If the endeavor was to say that what we are all striving to do, okay, albeit imperfectly most of the time, is to create a society where relations between men and women are more equal, more just. Well, is the way to do it to cross over? Is that the only way to do it? Or is the way to do it where you say that, well, a woman will continue to be a woman, but she will bring to the fore, wherever possible and to what extent possible, certain masculine qualities. And that men will continue to be men, but they need to, quote, let's use the conventional, very nice sentimental language of the day. They have to be nurturing, caring, so forth and so on. Right? You could say that that might actually be a better way, a much better way, and something that's much more realistic because it speaks to the conditions of the vast majority of people. I mean, how many people obviously are going to cross over? It's going to be a minuscule number. Minuscule number. All right? Now, this is one of the problems here. You see, he's not really describing. This is what worries me about the argument he's giving. There is a difference between being multicultural, right? And frankly, I've got very little patience for something called multiculturalism, because today it's really something that comes down from the state, if you ask me. And, you know, multiculturalism means, you know, yeah, you're you know, at your home in the evening at 7 o'clock and it's time for dinner and you don't have the energy to cook. So, yeah, okay, let me go to the internet. Do I want Chinese or do I want Greek or do I want Indian or do I want Moroccan food today? That's multiculturalism, you know. Okay, it's just consumption, frankly, for the most part. That's not a genuine engagement with another culture. You don't just engage with another culture by saying, yeah, today I'm going to eat Chinese, tomorrow I'm going to eat Moroccan, and then the next day I'm going to eat Japanese, and then the next day Korean, and then I can tell everybody how multicultural I am. Right? I mean, that's absolute nonsense, frankly. But that's what multiculturalism is, if you ask me. I mean, giving you the lower end of it, I know there are more sophisticated arguments, and not much better, frankly, if you ask me. Okay? There's a difference between being multicultural and being intercultural. And bicultural. Right? What he is describing is not, I mean, he might think he is. He might think he's actually describing people who are bicultural. I don't think so. And that's why that phrase crossing over. Because most of the people whose examples he gives are no longer really partaking of their own culture anymore. They've actually crossed over. They've converted, so to speak. They might literally have converted to, you know, a different faith, become Muslim, for example, right? They have now embraced that worldview and given up their own. The real challenge is to maintain a multiplicity of worldviews within yourself. And if he thinks that that's what they're doing, he needs to make an explicit argument. Frankly, there isn't one. And there isn't one in the rest of the book either for that, because I don't think he really is, in that sense, speaking about a world that is really bicultural, multicultural. Now, let me just read a little bit more of that paragraph down on page 7, and then we'll finish up with this matter pretty much. So beneath the familiar story of European conquest and rule in India and the imposition of European ways in the heart of Asia, there always lay a more intriguing and still largely unwritten story, the Indian conquest of the European imagination. Now, you see, I think that's overstated. The Indian conquest of the European imagination. So here are these few examples that he gives, and now suddenly we're talking about, the idea of India just completely conquered the European imagination. I mean, that's just really absolutely far-fetched, because most people in Britain, I mean, that's the astonishing thing, that most people in Britain had absolutely no interest in India at all from the outset until the very end. I mean, it's been shown repeatedly that when there was a debate on India that took place and that would take place in the House of Commons, okay, in the English Parliament, it was almost impossible to get a quorum. Okay, you couldn't get enough people to come to the debates. Yes, this is not to say that India did not figure in the imagination at all. I don't want to go to that other extreme as well. So, but how does it figure in? One of the ways it figures in, for example, is through textiles. That when, because what is it that's going from India, right? Remember what's going from India, right? What's going from India in this trade? A lot more going from India. You've got saltpeter. What is saltpeter? It's something that is used for armaments. And so as English armaments are going to increase, saltpeter, which is a raw material that you get from India, is going to be taken over. Textiles. Spices. And when I say textiles, I'm talking about cotton and silks. And it's very interesting, if you look at English social history in the 17th century, that there is no question that, historians have looked at that and agree, that the demand for these, when Indian textiles start to come to Britain, over a period of time, the demand for this is insatiable. Insatiable. Because England did not have a developed textile industry. And if you're wearing these, you know, rough woolen sacks, basically, which is what they were wearing, obviously you're getting these fine textiles, and India is like the king of textiles. Okay? You're getting these incredible textiles, and you're getting silks. And so if you look at how English women are dressing when they go to parties and balls, they are wearing very fine silk. The demand for cotton, which is a much more comfortable clothing than wool, is going to grow astronomically. Okay. Now, so to that extent, yeah. And where is all of this coming from? It's coming as a consequence of the trade. To that extent, you could say India was part of the European / British imagination. Right? But when he says the Indian conquest of the European imagination, this is really absolutely far-fetched. Okay, because then we'd have to see, well, what was the nature of the intellectual interaction, which English writers... So where do you see the Indian imagination in the work of, let's say, Locke? Okay? Right, just take a highly influential thinker, you know, who's going to become highly influential for the founding fathers, as they're called, of the United States. Right? Where's the Indian imagination there? There isn't any. Yes, I mean, there are going to be some writers. I think one way to make this argument, but it's a different argument, is that the company itself, by the early 1800s, had now become such a huge presence in India and was such a large affair that there were very few people in Britain who in some way or the other were not entangled with the company. That is, that you had a relative who was working in the company. It's like Indian, middle-class Indians today. You know, if you come from the 5-6 big cities in India, I have never met a middle-class Indian who didn't have some relative living in the United States. Okay? Either their uncle or aunt or grandnephew, grandniece, you know, you name it. Some obscure relative somewhere is there. I've never met a single person, I swear, from a middle-class Indian family living in Delhi or Bombay who does not have a relative in the United States. Okay? So what we're saying is that the company, by the early 1800s, was such a large affair that there were a great many people living in Britain who were now involved in the affairs of the company. One person I mentioned to you, I'll mention a few names just so that you start thinking about what this really means. So for example, James Mill, right? The author of the History of British India, right? And his son, his more famous son, John Stuart Mill. You might have read one of his essays in high school on liberty. Well, John Stuart Mill was an employee of the East India Company for 35 years. In fact, it's the only full-time job he ever had. You know, I mean, he ran for a seat in the House of Commons, got elected, and served as an MP for a few years, and then was thrown out. Intellectuals never last very long, you know, in places like that. Okay, right? So, but his only real full-time job was as an employee of the East India Company. Thomas Love Peacock, a relative of Coleridge. Any number of people you take like that, they're all working for the company. Okay? Charles Lamb, a very famous essayist. You know, Lamb's essays on Shakespeare, for example. His version of Shakespeare, which I remember reading in India, you know, as a young boy. Again, working for the company. So there were people that if you were living in London, for example, or even in northern England, the likelihood was that you had a family member, or you knew other families who had a family member who was an employee of the company, or was benefiting from the trade, because the company's employees were actually not that many in number, but the company had become a great corporation. To that extent, you could say, yes, India was present in the European imagination, but not the way that he means it. At all times up to the 19th century, but perhaps especially during the period 1770 to 1830, there was wholesale interracial sexual exploration. I love that neutral. Sexual exploration, right? You know, right? I mean, okay, just state it bluntly what this means, right? Sexual exploration. Now, not my words, right? And surprisingly, widespread cultural assimilation and hybridity. What Salman Rushdie, talking of modern multiculturalism, has called chutneyfication, you know? So you've heard of the Indian chutney and masala, right? So you put everything together. I mean, this is really quite absurd, frankly, if you ask me, okay? Virtually all Englishmen in India at this period Indianized themselves to some extent. That's what we mean, Indianization. You start smoking the hookah, you start sleeping with Indian women, you start, you know, dressing in Indian clothes, you eat Indian food, so forth and so on. All right, so I hope you keep in mind the caveats that I'm raising here. And then he also has this, I'll end with this quotation, okay? Because what we're doing here is we're sort of going through a critical exercise in how you read a text. You know, I might give you a passage, for example, from a book and say, just write two pages and deconstruct it, take it apart. And that's what you do. So what does he say? I won't give you these passages, obviously. India has always had, he says on page 7, India's always had a strange way with her conquerors. This, by the way, is immediately falling into this exoticism. You know, there's always something strange and exotic about the Orient. And that was, of course, one of the attractions that Englishmen had for Indian women. Oh, you know, these dainty damsels, they're really exotic, you know, right? In defeat, she beckons them. She beckons them in, then slowly seduces, assimilates, and transforms them. Right? So there are all these conquerors who come to India, you know, Alexander, the Afghans, the Turks, the Mughals, the British, the Portuguese, and what does India do? She beckons them in. You know, come into my parlor. Then slowly seduces, assimilates, and transforms them. Over the centuries, many powers have defeated Indian armies. But none has ever proved immune to this capacity of the subcontinent to somehow reverse the current of colonization. Right? You have to think about the consequences. Who's colonizing whom now? I really want to know. Right? That, yeah, they all came as colonizers, but you know, in the end, they all end up being colonized. Because India is this huge, humongous place. It just kind of swallows you up. This is what we used to call the sponge theory. You know, so you have a big sponge, and if you have a spill on your dining table, you know, the sponge will just absorb it, right? And then you have another spill, and then it'll absorb it again, right? Okay, so India is like this huge, gigantic sponge. Whoever comes into contact with India, they get swallowed up eventually. So vast is India, and so uniquely resilient and deeply rooted. Here, so deeply rooted. These are all code words. Unchanging India, encrusted. This is a different kind of Orientalism. This is what I call the romantic. This is what you might call the romantic Orientalism. Right? He's not saying India is a rotten place, right? Everybody lies there. They're all liars and cheaters and, you know. He's not saying that. In fact, he seems to be saying things that are very pleasant. Look at India. You know, it seems to be conquered, but it has its way of conquering everybody who comes to. Right? So, you know, the Indian nationalists might say, wow, well, this is just really wonderful. But you have to see the language here. Right? So vast is India, and so uniquely resilient, and deeply rooted. Deeply rooted. That there are social customs and practices which have existed for, you know, since time immemorial. Okay? Are intertwined social and religious institutions that all foreign intruders are sooner or later either shaken off or absorbed. Right? And I think I've said enough to indicate to you why I think this is not exactly a tenable view. So when you read a text like that, you have to take away what is promising. There's not much that's promising, frankly, here, but there is some. And that is that, yeah, there was a time, certainly, from, let's say, the early 1600s until the late 1700s, when social relations may have been different between the British and the Indians. At least among certain number of them, a certain classes of them, right? But then there's this whole critical apparatus that you'll have to apply as well. And I think the questions you want to take away then are, for example, how does one distinguish between multiculturalism and biculturalism and interculturalism, right? Was India a more open society? Is that one reason why the British were really attracted to India? These Britishers that he's talking about, that India was fundamentally a more open society. But that might also mean that the constraints that you had to go to church and all of that, frankly, didn't exist. Particularly when you moved away from the presidency towns, right? Because what's going to happen is that in the presidency towns, things are going to start to tighten up. Because when the numbers increase, there's going to be, you know, greater regulation. That is the numbers of Englishmen there. Right, more homogenization in a way. But if you're off in a small place in the bush, as they say, in countries like Australia, if you're off in the bush, you do whatever you want. You can become Hindoo Stuart, you know. Right? But, and of course, as British rule grows in India, the presidency towns will grow. There's going to be a greater concentration of English men over there. Right? And then eventually English women are going to come as well. Then there's also the factor that one of the reasons why some of the English were assimilating into India is because, frankly, once you arrived in India, you didn't really go back. And if you went back, you didn't come again. And that partly had to do with the expense and length of the voyages. I mean, this is, you know, it's not simply a matter of sitting on a plane and hopping over to a destination and then catching a flight back the next day, right? I mean, once you have gone over to India, particularly if you are from the subaltern class, you're working as a foot soldier, so to speak, for the East India Company. You know, once you go back to Britain, you want to go back with some wealth. Right? And then you're not coming back to India again. And of course, if you're staying in India for 10, 20, 30, 40 years, and remember one of the things he says, I mean, a little detail, it's an interesting detail, might have completely passed you by if you weren't paying attention, that 16 was the upper age. You had to join the East India Company by the time you were 16. And you know what the consequences are going to be later on? You're going to get these young fellows, 20, 21 years old. They're going to increase the age limit later on, right? And because once the company actually starts ruling India, what this means is that, well, you might be placed in charge of an entire district, and you're 20 years old. You don't even know the language. And you are finding yourself to be what is called the collector of that district, which may have a population of 1 million people. Right? But the roots of all of this are back in the early days when the company had essentially put a limit of 16. You also have to remember life expectancy was quite short. Of course, it was nowhere as short in Britain as it was going to be in India. I mean, I want to just mention to you, because this statistic will completely floor you, but it's a well-established statistic. Life expectancy in India, at close to the height of British rule in India, okay, early 1900s, is less than 20. Life expectancy. 19.4 is the life expectancy in India at that time. So when you hear this great narrative about how the English developed India, so forth and so on, keep that in mind too. That life expectancy was less than 20, okay, at that point in time. Right? And we're talking about the 20th century. Okay, let's now go back to the political narrative. Try to bring it up to 1757. So in 1707, Aurangzeb is going to die. Right? So, you know, he's had a long reign, 40 years. Like Akbar, one of his predecessors, a very long reign. The Mughal Empire has reached its zenith. It's, you know, it's gone all the way down to the south, right? Oh, this is a map over here. You know, so extending to western India, to what is today Pakistan, parts of Afghanistan, all the way to eastern India, okay? And almost down, nearly down to the tip of India. There's a portions of South India which are not going to be under the jurisdiction of the Mughal Empire. So it's a vast empire. And we've already spoken about what are some of the problems. That when you have these vast empires, and then retaining control over these vast empires is a difficult proposition. Now, there is this vacuum theory. The vacuum theory says that, well, Aurangzeb passed away. Already there were chinks in the armor, right? Already there were signs of splintering, even before his death. And it, for reasons that I've already described, how do you control people who are at the extremities? So the Nawabs of Bengal, now let's bring them into the picture. So the Nawab of Bengal is what? He's basically a feudatory of the Mughal Emperor. What does that mean? What that means in effect is that he collects, he reports, so to speak, if I may put it this way, to the Mughal Emperor, who's sitting in Delhi. Right? He reports to him. And he collects the revenue. He's obviously got people who are collecting the revenue. And I want you to also remember one thing. When revenue is collected, that means that you need an entire machinery of administration. How do you collect revenue? For example, you know, you've got, so the big landowners, they are called zamindars, right? So, you know, you may have, let's say, 1,000 zamindars. We're just taking a round figure, random round figure. But their land holdings might be quite different. Somebody might have 100 acres, somebody might have 200 acres or 300 acres. And obviously, you're not going to collect the same amount of revenue from all of these. So they obviously have very detailed records, right? So you need a machinery of administration. Let's not suppose for even a moment that there is no machinery of administration here, that this is just completely anarchic, lawless, which is how the British very often represented India, but of course they knew better, particularly when it came to such things as land assessment and revenue assessment. Right? So the Nawab, in short, is transmitting revenues to the Mughal Emperor. As early 1700s goes into the mid-1700s, he is increasingly going to splinter off. In other words, what is the Mughal Emperor going to do if he decides that he's going to set himself up as an independent ruler, which in effect he does? Okay? So we're here concerned only with the Nawab of Bengal at the moment, not with all the other Nawabs. and the other rulers in India, right? We're concerned with him because the narrative that we're going to be looking at, the British conquest of India, is the British conquest of Bengal, initially. And just to go ahead with the story for a second, then we'll go back again to the early 1700s. In the 1730s, 1740s, there are many other players involved. So by the way, the Marathas are an important player. For example, in the 1720s, 1730s, even though the Maratha armies are basically based here in Western India, they have been able to make encroachments all the way into Bengal. 1720s and 1730s. So now you're no longer just speaking about, when I said it's a guerrilla fighting force, I mean, it might be misleading in some respects, actually, because you might be thinking about a small force here or there. No, the Marathas have a very substantial army. And the fact that they're able to reach all the way to eastern India and then into Delhi, okay? Early 1800s, for example, the plunder of Delhi by the Marathas is, you know, a notorious chapter, okay? So the Marathas are able to make inroads into various parts of India, right? So the other actors I'm speaking about include groups such as the Marathas, but it also includes the Jagat Seths, or the bankers. So these are the bankers, right? And when I say bankers, what it means is that obviously you need, and you shouldn't be thinking of a centralized banking system here at all. But that's really the only word we can use in English is that for these people. You can describe them as financiers, okay, if you want, as bankers. And let me explain what that means very simply. What that means is that you have and this system, by the way, was well established in other parts of India too. I mean, the best example of that is the Gujaratis, okay? Because the Gujaratis were trading all over the world. Well, certainly all over the Indian Ocean world, right? I've spoken about this at very great length in one of my diaspora classes, where what we see is that the Gujaratis had such a presence, and not only in the Indian Ocean world, you know, and the two coasts of India. The Gujaratis, of course, come from Western India. It's today the state of Gujarat is a state adjoining the state of Maharashtra. Okay, but throughout the Gulf region, the east coast of Africa, the South China Sea, all of Southeast Asia to the southeast of India, right? The Malay archipelago, the Indonesian archipelago, that entire region, there is ample evidence that the Gujaratis were, you know, traders who had gone all over. You couldn't walk into a place without running into a Gujarati. I mean, that was how widespread it was. Now the Gujaratis had. So when you're doing this trading, you are sending a shipment, right? This is the sort of thing you need to think about, okay? So you're sending a shipment of goods from point A to point B, all right? Now, the Gujarati credit was so good that the Gujaratis didn't have to pay upfront very often for the shipments they were receiving, because you're a well-established trading community, you know? And you've got various methods for channeling money. You know, when it's abused, it becomes known as, you know what, right? Money laundering, it's called, right? But we're not speaking about money laundering here. You know, we're not talking about money being siphoned off illegally. We're talking about how Gujarati credit and trade networks were so well established that if a Gujarati is importing stuff 3,000 miles away, right, he doesn't have to pay upfront for that. His credit is good. Now, these bankers that we're talking about, they are operating in essentially the same system. That is that they are extending credit. Why do they have to extend credit? So, for example, when the Nawab of Bengal decides that he wants fortifications, okay, he wants to expand his army, he needs to take a loan. He doesn't have enough revenues to do it. Who is he going to go to? He's going to go to the Jagat Seths. These are the people who are crucial to the trade. And they're also crucial because they're also managing a whole lot of middlemen, right? You've got goods coming from the interior of the country and they're coming to the port. So when I talk about textiles, so forth and so on, that's what we're speaking about. That's the role they're playing. They are essentially bankers to the Nawabs of Bengal. That's who they are, the Jagat Seths. And they are an important player, no question about it. So if you write the history of the conquest of Bengal without any reference really to the Jagat Seths, it would be quite inappropriate because there are a great many players, but we'll have to be very careful about how we position these players. Because sometimes, and this is where I want to now go to a different reading, which you have, so you can see that many of the readings are directly relevant to some of the things I'm arguing for. So this is by a historian by the name of Chris Bailey, now Sir Christopher Bailey. He's just been knighted for his in Britain, so considered to be probably the major historian of India, certainly in Britain, and he does imperial history and all of that as well. Okay. One of the things that he says, which I think that we have to be a little alert about, is what exactly was going on, all right, at this point of time in the 1740s and 50s. And we'll go back again to slightly early period because I'm still talking about the Jagat Seths and all of these. So if you look at the chapter that was, the pages that were assigned to you, one of the impressions that is conveyed to my mind by what he says is that essentially you cannot write the history of the conquest of Bengal as a colonization by the British. That they were, the British were, and the exact words he uses, they were sucked in to the system. Now when he says sucked in, what he means is that you've got a whole array of actors there. You've got the Marathas lurking there in the background, you've got the Mughal emperor sitting in North India, then you've got the Nawabs of Bengal. All right? Okay? You've got the Jagat Seths. Yeah, these are all key actors here. And he's saying that, well, the British just happened to be another set of actors. And somehow things worked out. Effectively. Right? I think we have to segment the argument. We have to say that, yes, there are more players than nationalist history would have allowed for. Nationalist history would simply say, are there these British? They're going to come along and they're going to exploit divisions within Indian society. Right? And they're going to be able to take hold of India, putting it in a nutshell. And Bailey is saying that, well, actually, no, there are a great many actors here. For example, what was the complicity of the Jagat Seths? I already pointed that complicity. Remember that when the new Nawab is going to be installed in 1756, the Battle of Plassey is 1757, so the year before that, the new Nawab of Bengal, a young man, Siraj-ud-daulah, is going to come into power. And he is going to try to squeeze the Jagat Seths. Okay? He's going to try to squeeze them for credit, for money, so forth and so on. And the Jagat Seths are alarmed. So Bailey is saying we have to keep all of that in mind. Well, I certainly agree with that. But when he says that the British were, quote, sucked in, it's a little bit like that Dalrymple thing, if you ask me. You know? That sucked in means that, well, they're just one player, and there were these circumstances, you know, that really are much larger than any of the players involved. And willy-nilly, the British sort of found themselves ruling India. That's what, in effect, he's saying. And I think that we have to be a little cautious. But let's go back now, before we get to 1757. Okay? So Aurangzeb dies, and I mentioned to you there's this vacuum theory. What is a vacuum theory? Vacuum theory is, okay, Mughal Empire is going to begin to disintegrate. You remember that expression? You've all heard it. Nature abhors a vacuum, right? That's a vacuum theory. Somebody had to step in. Somebody had to step in. So you could say the Marathas tried to step in. In fact, they're going to have Maratha armies going into Bengal in the 1720s. But you might say that there were a number of reasons they couldn't succeed. One is that their reputation preceded them, notorious reputation. You could say that they're too far away from their center of power, which is Western India. Okay? Any number of reasons. You could say that they didn't have the military edge that the British had. You could say that, well, slowly what the Marathas did not realize is that the center had shifted to maritime powers. And they were not a maritime force at all. Marathas basically are a land force. Right? So three or four reasons why the Marathas did not succeed. So there may be other players. The vacuum theory is that, well, nature abhors a vacuum. The Mughal Empire is now collapsing, it's splintering. The Nawab of Bengal is going to slowly become more and more independent, right? And this was a perfect time for the British to step in. And to some extent, that is true. That obviously the circumstances, to some extent, we have to agree, were right. But it's not that circumstances are just there. They are made by a constellation of players, right? And one of those players early on is the successor to Aurangzeb, Farukh Siyar. That is the Mughal emperor in 1717. What does he do? Okay, now he might have been thinking also about his predecessors, especially Aurangzeb. And remember that Aurangzeb had been able to inflict a crushing defeat on the East India Company army. So in 1717, when the East India Company, you know, basically is going to ask him for some trading benefits and rights. So what does he do? He grants exemption from duties to East India Company in Bengal. Because when the company is trading, they have to give certain duties, right? Taxes, effectively. And he says, I'm going to exempt you from the payment of all taxes, right? In 1717, this exemption will now remain until the abolition of the company in 1858. By the way, officially the company is not actually abolished until the 1870s, but you know, I'll keep on saying abolish in 1857-58 because we're only interested in the company in relationship to India. The company existed as a paper force long after the rebellion of 1857-58 for almost two decades, but 1858 it's pretty much finished. The story has been written at that point in time. So this means that that in 1717, Farukh Siyar, when he grants this exemption from duties, it means that he is giving the British the right to trade without payment of custom duties, except for a very nominal sum of money, which is 3,000 rupees, which is exceedingly nominal. I mean, it's just a token amount. All right? So one of the reasons why he's doing it is because he might be thinking, well, the company is frankly not in a position to contest me. I can give these, you know, I can confer these grants. And of course, it's a sign of your greatness if you can bestow favors on others. All right. But the fact that the company is still in a subservient position to the Mughal throne at this point is indicated by the fact that the company is also conferring gifts. You know, so whenever a company official goes to meet the Mughal emperor, he has to take gifts with him. Okay, you confer a gift on your superior. When the superior confers a gift on you, that's from a different political point of view. That's a sign of his magnanimity. The British have to give these gifts because they are still indicating the fact that, well, we are here on your sufferance. That is that we are here because you are permitting us to be here. Okay? That's still the situation that we're speaking about. Now, keep in mind, this is where the Marathas come back in. So 1720s, 30s is a period of immense turmoil. 1739, there's going to be an invasion of India by Nadir Shah. Right? Nadir Shah is... Who's he, by the way? Anybody knows? Anybody done the history of... So he's the ruler of Persia. Okay? He's the ruler of Persia, and... it is absolute devastation. I mean, there are records, you know, of Nadir Shah coming there because he's come for the same reason that a great many other invaders came. Loot and plunder. And this is, again, we have to be very careful about the communalist interpretation because, you know, middle class Hindus will immediately go up in arms and say, oh, Nadir Shah, hey, another Muslim brute who comes into India. Well, yeah, he's a brute. And he's Muslim, but that's not the same as saying he's a Muslim brute. Okay? There's a difference. That he is interested in loot and plunder. He doesn't care where he gets the loot and plunder from. Very careful about that. Okay? And, you know, this is something that you really have to consistently keep in mind. You know, there's a man whom I talk about in my classes when I do the long span of Indian history, 4,000 years. Mahmud of Ghazni. Okay, so I want to give his example just so that you understand exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, and I can guarantee you, go to a middle class Hindu household and mention his name and see if somebody doesn't want to pick up a sword immediately, you know? Okay, and they just turn completely red in the face when they hear his name. You know, because he's a person who is viewed as, you know, a barbaric conqueror. Right? So Mahmud of Ghazni comes into India 17 times, raids India 17 times, circa 1000 AD. We're talking about much further back in time. And you know, there's this whole story about him raiding what is called the Somnath Temple, which was a temple that was full of riches. And by the way, some of these stories are not apocryphal. They are. I mean, I don't know how many of you read of this temple in South India 2 years ago, where they discovered, okay, in its inner vaults, right? They discovered jewelry, diamonds, rubies, pearls. The estimated value of that is $30 billion. It's 2 years ago, I'm talking about. Okay, so this is a Somnath temple because, you know, some of these Indian temples, they get 30, 40, 50,000 devotees a day. And when devotees come, they bring offerings. So the Somnath temple was this legendary temple. Mahmud of Ghazni went and plundered the temple. Okay, and so of course a Hindu historian will tell you, it just shows the hatred that Muslims had for Hindus. No, it doesn't show that at all. What it shows is that he's engaged in the politics of conquest. If there had been a Citibank at that time, he would have gone to Citibank and plundered Citibank. You go and plunder a temple because that's where the wealth is. Makes sense, you know. If you had, you know, a fort there with, you know, gold nuggets, okay, as they do in Texas, that's where you would go. This is the politics of conquest that we're talking about. Nadir Shah is engaging, frankly, in a kind of politics of conquest. India has what's called the peacock throne. You know, so this a majestic throne built entirely of gold. He's going to take it away. He comes, he loots, plunders, but he also creates devastation, right? Again, that's the barbarism of conquest sometimes. And when I say devastation, so the stories that are very often told is that, you know, he essentially is going to wipe out all the citizens of Delhi. Then he's going to pile up 50,000 heads into a tower. It's called the Tower of Heads. Right? I mean, the history books are full of them. But one of the things you have to be very careful is you have to see, well, how are we going to read it? Because one of the things that conquerors and their historians, okay, like to do is they like to exaggerate numbers, right? So you kill 500, you know, 50,000, you make it 500,000 because it just adds to your glory. Hey, just look at how many people we cut down. Right? You've got to be careful with how you read these numbers. Because frankly, if you start tallying up all the numbers, go through this exercise of how many people were killed. You read all the accounts. They killed more people than existed in that place, you know, very often. But nonetheless, what is very clear is that Nadir Shah left behind a trail of devastation, ruin and devastation. So what are we speaking about? What we're speaking about? And he is invading North India, because he's coming through the Khyber Pass, as all others have. And he gets into places like Delhi, you know, which is where the Mughal Empire is based. And what does this show you? What it shows you is the Mughal Emperor is now a paper tiger, effectively. He's not able to do anything. I mean, he's got a whole army, all of that, but he's not able to stop Nadir Shah. Right? So, you know, when we get to the 1750s now, 40s and 50s, what we're really saying is that there was already substantial political turmoil in India. The Mughal emperor was not in a position to do very much about it. Okay? Number three, that his vassals, his feudatories, and we're interested in the one in Bengal for the moment, had now already splintered off, set themselves up effectively as independent rulers. All right, so now let's get into the 1740s, take 2-3 minutes to set it up. And then we'll have to look in some detail at the Battle of Plassey. We're not going to spend too much time on this so-called battle itself. We're interested in the consequences. So 1743, you have a man called Clive who comes to India. Clive, who is he? He is essentially an employee of the East India Company. He's an employee of the East India Company. He comes to India and he's going to be there for 10 years. All right? And then he's going to go back. He's going to go back. He served a fairly long term, but he's going to be called back and he's going to come back and he's going to be based in Madras in South India. Now, 1756, let's turn our attention to this year. And that's where we'll stop. I just want to tell you what happens in 1756. Okay? So 1756, a new Nawab comes into power in Bengal. His name is Siraj-ud-daulah. You'll find this all, by the way, in the readings, and you can obviously listen to the lectures again and go back and get the names. And you can go to the website that I have called Manas, which I mentioned to you in the opening lecture, which has a substantial number of articles, including a whole article on the Battle of Plassey. Short pieces, but you know, you get the bare details at least. Siraj-ud-daulah is a young Nawab. He comes into power, and he is worried about the fact that the British are getting really powerful. You know, they're building fortifications without his permission. Okay, so they already have, you know, there's already the Fort St. William, but they're adding fortifications, which means you add cannon, for example. And as far as he is concerned, the British are still in a position of subservience to him, and they need his permission. But the British, of course, by this time have realized that, well, they really have the edge in many respects. Okay, so essentially, Siraj-ud-daulah is going to be locked into battle with the British. He's going to make demands. They're not going to agree to them. And they realize that a confrontation is, you know, on the horizon. Clive is supposed to be a good military official, enterprising. So he is going to be asked to come to Bengal. Okay? That's the setting that we have in 1756, 1757. Right? The character that you need to think about is, other than Siraj-ud-daulah and Clive, is Mir Jafar. Mir Jafar is related to Siraj-ud-daulah. The British are going to strike a deal with Mir Jafar, and they're going to say to Mir Jafar, we will install you as a Nawab of Bengal, okay, if you assist us. If you assist us. Right? So that's, of course, this is field day for the nationalists now, because they'll say, ah, British rule in India was based on betrayal. Right? You get one Indian to betray another. It's not like there was any inherent superiority. The British were just a little bit more cunning than us, frankly. I mean, a little more devious, a little bit more dishonest. You know? Okay, you know, you don't have to get nationalist pride. Doesn't necessarily mean that you have to project yourself as honest, virtuous, all of that. It just means that the other group of people a bit more savvy about what to do in a situation. All right? So we stop there, and we're going to look at this, Clive, Warren Hastings, British administrations in India.